Joe Negri Presents is a production of WDUQ-FM, Pittsburgh.
Hi, this is Joe Negri. Yeah, the same Joe Negri that you know as Handyman Negri on Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. This is the Joe Negri who has worn many hats in his life, but my most individual headdress has always been that of the jazz guitar player. I really think I was destined to be a jazz guitar player. I came into the world about the same time the acoustic jazz guitar was introduced. You know, prior to that, most jazz bands used the tenor banjo as part of the rhythm section because of its volume and tonal quality. That allowed it to cut through the ensemble. Now, guitar-like instruments have been a part of civilization for centuries. In the Middle East, for example, the oud, one of the guitar's most distinctive predecessors, was very prominent. Eventually, plucked string instruments like the lute found their way into Europe. They made their way to Italy, to Spain, and to Elizabethan England. So if you're thinking that Elvis and the Beatles were responsible for the popularity of the guitar, well, think again. Its acceptance throughout a complex and fascinating history has been really astonishing. But we're talking jazz guitar here. On this, the second of our two-part series devoted to this personal art form, I'm going to take you on a journey from the post-Charlie Christian era right up to the present. We concluded our first program with the enormously influential Charlie Christian. And boy, was he ever influential. Legions of jazz guitar players owe a debt to Charlie Christian. I know I do. He was my first influence and my first introduction to jazz guitar. Right now, we're going to start the program with one of Charlie's disciples. You're listening to the wonderful Oscar Moore. That was Oscar Moore. He was playing his own composition, Lament in Chords, which was recorded with the Nat Cole Trio in 1947. You know, with Charlie Christian's death, Oscar Moore became one of the top guitarists in jazz. He was a very versatile guitar player. He was good with chords and comping and solo playing. And so he was kind of a real triple threat guitarist. There were so many other guitar players from that time. We're going to try to include a few more. Here is a fella named Irving Ashby, who took Oscar Moore's place with the Nat Cole Trio. And you're also going to hear a little bit from Tiny Grimes. What more can you say about a guitar player who works with the great Art Tatum? You know he had to be good. And one of the ladies of jazz guitar, Mary Osborne. Here they are. You just heard Mary Osborne doing Allen's Alley, one of the standard pre-bebop tunes. I remember playing that song a lot. And then before Mary, you heard Tiny Grimes doing his version of Body and Soul with the Art Tatum Trio. And to start the set was Irving Ashby's Tip Top Bop, another original by him. Right now, you're listening to a 1953 recording of Salute to Charlie Christian. That was something that Barney Kessel did and put together himself. He was such a disciple of Charlie's. All of these guys came from the Oklahoma, Texas area. Barney Kessel, Charlie Christian, Herbie Ellis, several more. And they all had a very distinctive quality to their playing. Thank you. was Barney Kessel. You know, after this, when bebop became the language of choice in the late 40s and early 50s, guitarists had a lot of woodshedding to do. I remember the first time I heard Diz and Charlie Parker playing Groovin' High, I thought, wow, how am I ever going to get that on the guitar? And years later, many years later, I was talking with Tal Farlow and Jimmy Rainey, both who had a lot to do with translating the language of bop. And we had a good laugh over the fact that all three of us had to go into the woodshed and do some serious practicing to get that bebop style down so that we could express it on the jazz guitar. Tal Farlow was really one of the originators of the bop style on guitar. He was one of the first. I remember Tal. He came from North Carolina and came to New York. And I was playing with a band there, and he came back to visit us. I had seen him the night before in a jazz club, so he comes to the theater. And he's real impressed with the fact that I can read music. And he's looking at the parts, and he's so amazed. He said, "You read all those notes, huh?" And I said, "Yeah." But Tal was really a spectacular guitar player. They called him the fastest guitar player of the era, and that probably was true. I don't know many people that could play any faster than Tal. Here he is doing Strike Up the Band, 1954, with Gerald Wiggins, Ray Brown on bass, and Chico Hamilton on drums. Well, that was the fastest guitar player of his era, Tal Farlow. Tal played Strike Up the Band. We're going to move on now to another Southern gentleman, a fellow from Louisville, Kentucky, Jimmy Rainey. You know, where Tal was bigger-than-life kind of person, Jimmy Rainey was a gentle, easygoing kind of guy, but a marvelous guitar player who really helped transcribe the language of bebop to the jazz guitar. Here's Jimmy Rainey doing Spring Is Here with Hall Overton, Teddy Kotick, Nick Stabulis on drums, and a local friend of ours from Pittsburgh, Dr. John Wilson on trumpet. ¶¶ You just heard Jimmy Rainey, one of the leading exponents of jazz guitar in the 50s. He and Tal Farlow were probably the leaders. But there were more. There was a fellow named Chuck Wayne, who I remember as a wonderful, warm, and generous kind of a guitar player. He didn't mind sharing ideas with you. He worked out a series of interesting arpeggios for the guitar, and I'll never forget him showing me that. It was complex and kind of difficult, but that was Chuck. Chuck's going to be working here on a song called Conception with the George Shearing Quintet, very popular group at the time. We're going to follow Chuck Wayne with Herb Ellis. Now, Herb was from Texas, and another marvelous guitar player with a very bluesy kind of a style about him. And Herbie spent a lot of years with Oscar Peterson and our own Pittsburgh bass player, Ray Brown. Following Herb, we're going to hear from another local phenom. He hailed from Johnstown, Pennsylvania. His name was Joe Passalacqua. You all know him as Joe Pass. Joe was a fantastic guitar player, did a lot of solo work. His virtuoso albums are just some of the best guitar playing ever. Following Joe, we're going to hear from a young man from Philadelphia whose star burned very brightly for a short time. His name was Billy Bean. Johnny Pisano, who is still very much alive in the guitar world and doing wonderful things, rediscovered Billy Bean. And in fact, John had a lot to do with recording Billy and getting him out to the world. So we're going to hear something from Billy Bean. But right now, here is Chuck Wayne playing Conception. Thank you. Billy Bean. Just heard Billy Bean, a young guitarist from Philadelphia, playing Fat Feet with Johnny Pisano. And before that, Joe Pass's phenomenal Night and Day, Herbie Ellis on Naptown Blues, and we opened this segment with Chuck Wayne doing Conception with the great George Shearing Quintet. We haven't touched on any of the country or western swing guitarists who were also formidable jazz players. How can we forget that Les Paul, George Barnes both honed their skills as country players, and Jimmy Weibel, boy, what a great guitar player he was. He worked with Frank Sinatra for a long time and also was a stalwart West Coast studio musician. Well, Weibel began as one of Bob Wills' Texas Playboys. But one of my favorites and a true bop stylist was Hank Garland. Hank was an esteemed Nashville session player. He recorded with everybody from Elvis to Webb Pierce. In 1960, Hank put out an album which really showed him to be one of the top bebop jazz guitar players of his time. Here he is playing Move, which also features another great jazz player, Gary Burton. Thank you. That was Hank Garland playing Move, 1960. Shortly thereafter, and very tragically, in 1961, Hank was seriously injured in a car accident, which ultimately just ended his career. What a great player he was. At this point in the program, we're going to move into something with very, very special guitar players, each one of them with their own voice. I call them guitar stylists. The section includes Les, Johnny, Wes, and Jim. Les Paul will lead us off. Les Paul, what can you say about him? Not only a great guitar player, but such an inventive person. People know him today for all of the wonderful things that he did, and even invented a solid body guitar that's revered by young people all over. Following Les is a personal favorite of mine, Johnny Smith. I happen to know Johnny well, and he's still living, not playing anymore, but enjoying his fishing. Following Johnny, Wes Montgomery, probably in a lot of people's minds the most influential guitar player of all time, and truly a phenomenal musician. Jim Hall will wind up that list. So here it is, Les Paul, Johnny Smith, Wes Montgomery, and Jim Hall. Wes Montgomery. Thank you. You just heard a sampling of some of the most unique guitar stylists of the mid-20th century. You heard Jim Hall doing I've Got You Under My Skin with Bill Evans, Wes Montgomery's Unit 7, Johnny Smith playing The Girl Next Door, and we started that set with Les Paul doing Running Wild. You know, we certainly could have included Billy Bauer in that list. Billy Bauer spent a lot of time on the New York jazz scene. Also George Barnes, and a wonderful guitar player who came from Canada and did a lot of recording here, burned out very young. His name was Lenny Bro. Jazz guitar went through an interesting change in the 60s, late 60s. It was the influx of the Brazilian style of music. Now, many, many classically trained guitarists, fingerstyle, not pick style, came on the scene. And some of these included Lorinda Almeida from Brazil, João Gilberto from Brazil, and somebody from America was Charlie Byrd, who studied in the Washington, D.C. area and I think lived in Virginia. And all of these guys made a very important contribution to jazz guitar. We're going to start off by listening to Lorinda Almeida with the Stan Kenton Orchestra in 1947, playing his own Lament for guitar. And following Lorinda will be something by Charlie Byrd, and also something by João Gilberto. Charlie Byrd. Thank you. João Gilberto.
É pau, é pedra, é o fim do caminho, o resto de toco um pouco sozinho. Um caco de vidro, é a vida, é o sol, é a noite, é a morte, é o laço, é o anzol. É peroba do campo, nó da madeira, caingá, candeia, é uma tita pereira. É madeira de vento, tombo da ribanceira, é o mistério profundo, queira ou não queira. É o vento ventando, é o fim da ladeira, é a viga, é o vão. Festa da gomieira, é a chuva chovendo, é conversa ribeira. Das águas de março, é o fim da canseira. É o pé, é o chão, é a mastradeira. Passarinho na mão, pedra da tiradeira. Uma ave no céu, uma ave no chão. Um regato, uma fonte, um pedaço de pão. É o fundo do poço, é o fim do caminho. No rosto desgosto, é um pouco sozinho.
A stone, it's the end of the road, it's the rest of a stump, it's a little alone. It's a sliver of glass, it is life, it's the sun, it is night, it is death, it's a trap, it's a gun. The oak when it blooms, a fox in the brush, the knot in the wood, the song of a thrush, the wood of the wind, a cliff, a fall, a scratch, a lump. It is nothing at all, it's the wind blowing free, it's the end of the slope. It's a beam, it's a void, it's a hunch, it's a hope. And the riverbank talks of the waters of March. It's the end of the strain, it's the joy in your heart. The foot, the ground, the flesh and the bone. The beat of the road, a slingshot stone. A fish, a flash, a silvery glow. A fight, a bet. The range of a bow, the bed of the well, the end of the line, the dismay in the face, it's a loss, it's a find, a spear, a spike, a point, a nail, a drip, a drop, the end of the tail, a truckload of bricks in the soft morning light, the shot of a gun in the dead of the night, a mile, a must, a thrust, a bump, it's a girl, it's a rhyme, it's a coat, it's the mumps. The plan of the house, the body in bed, and the car that got stuck. It's the mud, afloat, adrift, a flight, a wing, a hawk, a quail. The promise of spring, the riverbank talks of the waters of March. It's the promise of life, it's the joy in your heart.
Classical guitar players playing jazz, finger style rather than pick style. You just listened to João Gilberto doing Água de Março, The Waters of March by Antonio Carlos Jobim. Before that, Charlie Bird doing another Jobim tune called How Insensitive. And we opened the set in a very special way with Lorinda Almeida and the Stan Kenton Orchestra playing Lament for guitar. And now we enter the world of contemporary jazz guitar. What a world it is. If you think there are a lot of rock guitarists out there, wait till you hear the names of some of these jazz guitar players who are doing marvelous things today. Here's Bucky Pizzarelli, who I've known for a long, long time. And he's a very versatile guitar player, studio player, seven-string guitar, one of the early disciples of the seven-string. Grant Green, really phenomenal and very popular guitarist. He's popular today with the young people. Had a bluesy style. I think he was a disciple of Wes Montgomery's. Pittsburgh's own Georgie Benson. There are those who say, oh, Georgie's not a jazz guitar player. Well, I got news for you, friends. He's a wonderful jazz guitar player. He's also a good singer, too. Jimmy Bruno, a dear friend from Philadelphia who comes here to the Duquesne guitar camp every year and joins us. He's an outstanding soloist and somebody with just unbelievable technique. Pat Martino, a very classy guy and a very classy guitar player. Pat marches to his own drummer, and he plays his own way, and he has his own approach to the guitar, and it's a good one. Russell Malone worked with Diana Krall for many, many years. A marvelous guitar player, traditional in many ways, but avant-garde in many ways. Bill Frisell. This fella should fit with those unique guitar stylists because he certainly is a special guitar player. He plays a solid body guitar, but he makes it sound like a jazz guitar. John Scofield, certainly a favorite of the younger crowd. He has kind of quasi-rock roots, but he's turned them into a unique hybrid of jazz and fusion. Pat Metheny, certainly the most popular of the contemporary guitar players. Great composer, does a lot for jazz, has his own special style about him. I'd also like to mention Emily Remler, a dear guitar player. She worked a little bit with Herbie Ellis when she first started, and she did a lot of recordings on her own. Unfortunately, she left us much too soon. Kurt Rosenwinkel, a young guy on the scene in New York City today, that all my young students really admire. He's saying a lot of wonderful things. Contemporary guitar has seen a return to the roots of Django Reinhardt from the 30s and early 40s. The gypsy manouche style, people like Borelli Legrin, Dorota Schmidt, Rosenberg, and this wonderful guitarist, Martin Taylor. You're listening to Martin Taylor playing a Django tune called Minor Swing. I'd like to include myself in this list. Joe Negri, I'm going to be doing Sweet and Lovely, which is a recording, a cut from Uptown Elegance. An arrangement was done by Dr. John Wilson, and we talked about him earlier. Well, you know, I've traveled a pretty long road here. I started in the swing era. Big bands were still around for a few years, and then bebop came in. played bebop guitar. I think you could still classify me as a swing bebop guitarist, but I do love the chord style. I'd like to play solo guitar. I kind of enjoy doing a little bit of all the guitar styles, including the Brazilians, though. Tried to give you a sampling of some of the contemporary guitarists and their unique distinctive approaches to the instrument. There were other avant-garde stylists such as Sonny Chirac, Derek Bailey, who expanded on the language, but by and large, the guitar's voice still today remains tonal and swinging. I'm Joe Negri, and I hope you've enjoyed the fascinating story of the development of the jazz guitar. You know, we've just heard some of the world's greatest jazz guitarists. And don't forget, the jazz guitar is still in its infancy. We certainly can't predict what the future of jazz guitar is going to be, but we can be sure of one thing. The future jazz guitar greats will have learned their lessons from the masters of the past and the present. I've loved and treasured them all. I can honestly say that I've never met a jazz guitar player that I didn't like. Until next time, happy picking and keep swinging.
This is Tony Mowat, founder of the Pittsburgh Jazz Society and your devoted jazz companion. I've had the pleasure of knowing Joe Negri for most of my career, not only as a friend, but as one of the finest jazz guitarists in the country. I'm so glad that Joe finally had the opportunity to share his vast knowledge of jazz guitar's illustrious history. Mark Iacovone produced this two-part series. The production engineer was Chris Procopio at Sound Technologies. Special thanks to WDUQ's John Johnson, Shauna Machowski, Mike Plaskett, Bob Studebaker, and Helen Wigger. Thanks also to Joe Barth, author of Voices in Jazz Guitar, Mel Bay Publications, and Susan Blackman, Director of Arts Programs, Greater Pittsburgh Arts Council. Mr. Negri's website is joenegri.com. This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency through its Regional Arts Funding Partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts. State government funding comes through an annual appropriation by Pennsylvania's General Assembly. The Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts is administered in Allegheny County by Greater Pittsburgh Arts Council. This has been a production of W.